Welcome to Church on the Rock Community Worship Service. Why don't we give the Lord a hand clap of praise right now? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We're excited about what God is doing. We have a number of guests in the house today. We're so grateful to have you at Church on the Rock. Amen. And we have some that I don't know where they are, but we're here and we can have church this morning. Amen. And so we're glad that you are here also. A few things that I want to remind you of as we get started here. Remember to turn in your Touch 300 cards every week with our connections and contacts that we make throughout the week. Remember our Wednesday night life source at 7 o'clock. Friday morning prayer through the end of October at 9 o'clock in the morning. First Responder Sunday, next Sunday. Everybody say next Sunday. October 27th, during the community worship service, invite your family and friends who are first responders, police, firefighters, medical professionals. And we got flyers to hand out that are available in our hostess stations in the Welcome Center in the lobby. A free meal will be served to all of our first responders after service. If you're not a first responder, meals are available for purchase for $8 a plate. And they're to-go meals. Menu will be pulled pork, potato salad, baked beans, Texas toast, and I'm making you hungry. So we got that all taken care of. Brother and Sister Parker need some volunteers to help deliver brownie gifts, packs, and flyers and invitations for First Responders Sunday. So see Sister Parker after service. They're going to be doing it Wednesday through Friday of this coming week. We're going to try to hit all the police stations and fire stations and various other places. And so see her to be able to assist with this in this coming week. Trunk or Treat, Wednesday night, October the 30th. Sign up on the KOTR bulletin board to be a part of this and to bring a trunk full for our children. And pumpkin roll fundraiser time has come around again. Help us by selling pumpkin rolls for the Thanksgiving season. All proceeds will go to the building fund and paying off our final little bit of debt that we have. And we have order forms and flyers in the lobby available. Please see Sister Jennifer, Sister Davidson for more information. Why don't you stand together with me? And I want you to go find somebody and tell them, I am glad that you are at Church on the Rock today. Why don't we do that together and greet one another in Jesus' name?
Praise the Lord, everybody. As we return to our seats, Sister Davidson, would you join us on the platform, please? You may be seated for just a moment. So today is a special day. We are celebrating Pastor Appreciation Day. Today is the day that we get to show honor and a lot of extra love to the amazing people that the Lord has placed in our lives as our pastor and bishop. We as a church family, we want to say how much we appreciate you, Brother and Sister Davidson, for your countless sacrifices, your time and energy that you give daily to Church on the Rock. We thank you for the prayers, the wise counsel, and guidance that you give to each of us. We thank you for the love that you continuously give. Brother Davidson, thank you for preaching the word without fear or favor, for always speaking the truth in love, even when it's not the most comfortable thing to say. For these things, we say thank you from the bottom of our heart. Also today, we are most thankful for Pastor and Sister Kurtz, and even though they're not able to be here in service with us today, they are here with us in their heart. And on behalf of Church on the Rock, Brother and Sister Kurtz, when you watch this, we honor you today for answering the call of God and taking the next step in your ministry to come back home to Gadsden to be mentors and guide us in our future. As Brother and Sister Davidson has led and continued to lead us to high heights, We know that the addition of Brother and Sister Kurtz to this amazing pastoral team will take us to even greater heights as Bishop Davidson and Pastor Kurtz work hand in hand. Jeremiah 3:15 says, "And I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding." And Ephesians 4:11-12 says, "And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ." Today, Bishop and Sister Davidson and Pastor and Sister Kurtz, we honor you and we say we love you from the depths of our heart. Brother and Sister Davidson, and we do have gifts for Brother and Sister Kurtz, but they're not here today to receive those. But we do have a gift that we'd like to give you. In the gift bag, we have prepared a gift of encouragement. It includes in the gift our small messages from our Church on the Rock family. We ask that on days when you need uplifting and encouragement that you go to this box and take out a message from one of us and let it be a blessing to you. Also in the cards are gifts for you. And as we close this out, if you're willing, we would like you and Sister Davidson to step down front, and we would like Brother Gully and the prayer team and any of you all that would be willing to gather around, and we would like to pray a prayer of blessing upon you all and Brother and Sister Kurtz as we go forward into this new future of Church on the Rock.
Thank you, Church on the Rock, for all the love that you pour out on our pastoral team every week, every Sunday when you serve and when you come and lift them up. We are so thankful. But I wonder if we could all stand and get ready to enter into a time of worship and praise as we celebrate the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Can you worship him with me? Lord, we thank you, God. We are so thankful for your presence we already feel in this place, God. And I ask that you would continue to move and pour your spirit out, Lord. Lord, we thank you for all you're going to do. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Our rock, the only solid ground. champion. He's never lost a battle. He took the keys of death, hell, and the grave. I don't have to worry about what's going to happen. I've read the end of the book. It's a mine. It's a mine. I'm victorious. Yes. Hallelujah. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. You are the only king forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher.
Just on my mind, and now I realize what it was all about. The Lord is my shepherd. Amen. Just those few words express how blessed we are. The Lord is my shepherd. Amen. And with that in mind, let's get ready to go before the Lord in prayer. If there's anybody in the house who would like to come forward and have the elders of the church anoint you with oil, pray for your needs, you're welcome to come forward at this time. If there are any unspoken requests, you can let it be known by the raising of your hands. Amen. Praise God. All right. We want to remember in prayer this morning, Brooke Harbin, and continue to pray for Jerry Collier and Sister Montez Mayer. And also, Brother Zach has asked us to pray for two of his close friends, Jonathan Evans and Jordan Sampleson. Amen. Let's pray, church. Lord God, we thank you, the Lord Jesus, for loving us enough to be the Lord Jesus, a shepherd for us. And not only you being a shepherd for us, the Lord God, but to giving us an under-shepherd, the Lord Jesus. Oh, mighty God, that our paths may be straight, the Lord God, that our steps may be ordered. The Lord God, we come before you this morning asking you to let your healing power go out, the Lord God, and touch those, the Lord God, that are hurting this morning in body, the Lord God. Oh, God, let the power of your spirit move, the Lord Jesus, that those who are fighting battles in the mind, the Lord God, that the enemy has given to us, the Lord God, that we might be distracted from what you have called us to do, the Lord Jesus. God, you are our strength. You are our salvation. The Lord God, you are the satisfier of our souls. Dear Jesus, work in our behalf. Use the man of God this morning to speak into our spirits that we may be strengthened, the Lord God, that your will may be done in our lives. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Thank you, the Lord God, for being who you are in our lives. None like you. None like you. Amen. We're going to continue to worship God this morning as we receive this morning's offering.
You're never gonna let me down.
for your faithfulness. Can we love him right now? Come on, let's invite his presence into this sanctuary. Yes, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your goodness, oh God. Hallelujah. You never fail. You never fail. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Beautiful, so kind and lovely.
name of Jesus Christ right now. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We glorify your magnificent name. You are marvelous and holy. None like you, Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, and we worship you from the depth of our being today. Oh, your presence is so real in this house, oh God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Amen, 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 amen. Beautiful presence of the Holy Spirit here. You can turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 8. You might want to leave them open there. I do want to say specifically to Cheryl Powell, welcome home. Amen. They left here a thriving young couple and came back as grandpa and grandma. I am sure in today's culture they don't let anybody call them that, but amen. Good to have y'all home today and all our guests. We're so glad that you're here at Church on the Rock. Amen. And I do want to give you a little bit of an update. Kurt should be able to start moving into their home the first couple of weeks in November. And hopefully we'll be on vacation permanently here by the end of November. Back and forth a little bit until that time. But we're looking forward to that. Amen. It must be pretty good for me because I went to my semi-annual medical checkup and it was amazing because just everything about it just went up and best report I got in 4 years. So, amen. If I get getting better, I might start running the aisles before this thing is over with. Amen. I want to turn to Romans chapter 8, verse 26. I'll be, as I said, reading quite a bit. This is kind of expository this morning and kind of a examination of a chapter, but I want to focus on one part of it in particular, beginning with verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Those two verses are so deep that you can explore them for 10 years and still be exploring them. Verse 28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, he also predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us. And this really, it does have a question mark behind it, but it also should have an exclamation point. Amen. If God be for us, who can be against us? It's almost a rhetorical question. It is a rhetorical question because there's really no answer to this question. The answer is, if God be for us, it doesn't really matter. Let me put it to you in Alabama vernacular, it don't amount to a hill of Kentucky Wonder Beans who's against you if God is for you. I want to preach about a higher dimension of living. Everybody say in Jesus' name. You may be seated. Romans chapter 8 is an amazing chapter, one that could provide weeks of teaching material. In a way, it's a narrative documenting one's road from salvation to being a strong, overcoming child of God. In another sense, it's one of the most powerful chapters for New Testament doctrine, the beliefs of the early church. So I'm going to cover a few of those doctrinal punches from this chapter. Number one, we read about the redemption by the grace of God. Number two, we read about the oneness of God in this chapter. Number three, we read about the essentiality of the baptism of the Holy Spirit in this chapter. Number four, we realize that the essentiality of walking in the Spirit once the individual has been filled. Number five, we understand the power of an aggressive prayer life. And number six, the predestination of the church in the sense that the church as a body is predestined to be a walking church of testimonial victory and living a righteous life. The individual is not predestined to be in the church, but there is a church predestined to be an overcoming body, and I want to be a part of that body. And then number seven, the absolute security one has in God when he walks in the Spirit. Each of these points can constitute a Bible study, and I would briefly cover some of them this morning. But my main focus today is about living in a life of power and victory in this present world, or a higher dimension, or it's placed one time in Scripture as a life more abundantly. The warning that I give you is this message is about spiritual principles, so the carnal-minded will struggle with understanding because according to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, the things of the Spirit are not carnally discerned. It's like speaking a foreign language to those who cannot speak the languages of God. So we begin with point one in Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. This is a basic promise to all believers, and most Christian movements can easily go to this passage. There is now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. However, many do not grasp the spiritual importance of the attached proviso. One must walk in the Spirit for this to be true. It's not a promise to those who walk in the flesh. It's not a promise to those who pursue carnal pursuits, but it's a promise to those who make up their mind that they're going to walk in the Spirit contrary to the direction of this world. And the next several verses explore the contrast between walking in the flesh, or carnality, and walking in the Spirit. Very well summed up in Romans chapter 8, verses 5 and 6. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. It is impossible to get spiritual understanding with a carnal mind. Jesus said to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. It is impossible for the Spirit to produce a carnal result, and it's impossible for the flesh to produce a spiritual result. What is a carnal mind, you may ask? Human logic and reasoning. I do not mean to offend, but truth is truth. If you do not have a consistent prayer life, you are operating from a carnal mind, because none of us are spiritual minded by our natural birth. Every one of us, according to what the psalmist said in Psalm 51, are born in sin and shapen in iniquity. A carnal mind does not necessarily constitute an evil mind. It simply means that you're operating from human reasoning, not from spiritual principles. And the verse is very clear. It is absolutely impossible for a person like this to please God. It is impossible to please God and walk in logic and human reasoning. It is impossible to please God and try to be a Christian from your own mind and from your own thinking. There is a miraculous transformation that is necessary for salvation. Jesus himself said it to Nicodemus. You can't educate yourself into this, but you must be born of the water and of the Spirit. There is a miracle of salvation, and you can't obtain salvation without the miracle. And we have felt the presence of that miracle in this house this morning, and we know his power is here. But if you're trying to be a logical Christian, it's not going to work. If you're trying to be a Christian simply by your education and educating yourselves in certain ways, it's not going to work. But if you learn how to pray in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit and have the power of God working in your life, you can live an overcoming life for Jesus Christ. Amen. So Paul then explores the necessity of being filled with the Spirit. He spends a few verses identifying, and I could spend all day on this one. He spends a few verses identifying the miracle of the Spirit. He calls it the Spirit. He calls it God. He calls it the Spirit of God. He calls it Christ. He calls it the Spirit of Christ. And he calls it the Spirit of him who raised up Christ from the dead. So when he uses all these terms referring to one Spirit, we got to believe that there's just one God, and his name is Jesus. And there's power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. He's not talking about a whole committee come to help us here. He's talking about one God who became man and made it possible that you and I can live powerful, overcoming. I'm taking you to a different dimension in this message this morning, not just a casual Christianity of stopping by every once in a while and saying hello to God, but I'm talking about a people who can walk in this world and not be tainted by this world, who can walk in this world and not be influenced by this world, who can walk in this world and live a victorious life in this world. It is possible for those who will plug in to the Spirit of the Almighty God. Hallelujah. Everybody say it's possible. Amen. So, this is about as oneness as it gets there. The point is to establish the miracle of the Spirit, though. Same Spirit that raised up Christ from the dead in you. The same Spirit that raised up Christ from the dead in you. Romans 8:9 nails this point home. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. That is absolutely clear. And he uses the term Spirit of God and Spirit of Christ as one here. And he tells us that if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Or in other words, this whole thing hinges on a person being born again of the water and of the Spirit. Because if this happens in your life, you step into a new dimension of living, into a new power relationship where you can be an overcomer in this world, and you are not constantly tossed about by the things of this world, and we're not sad, and we're not broken down, and we're not in turmoil, but we have a peace that defies logic, that passes understanding, because we have the Spirit working within our lives. And it goes beyond this. Romans 8:14 is definitive. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. It is not enough to receive the Spirit at new birth, but to be called a son of God, one must be led by God. I'm afraid that there are too many, even in this congregation, who can point to a time when they received the gift of the Holy Ghost, but their lifestyle does not testify that they are daily led by the Spirit. You understand, it's not enough just to receive the Spirit, but Paul said, you're not really a son of God until you are led by the Spirit, until your actions are determined by the Spirit. We don't live Monday through life, a Saturday gratifying the flesh and come in for a visit on God on Sunday, but we live overcoming lives 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. There's something different about us because he has put his Spirit in us, and we are not like the world, and we are not of the world. Amen. These simple words should be taken soberly. Oh, yes. How many people have come through and repented, baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost? Their lifestyles don't change. Why is that? Because they're not led by the Spirit. Somebody said that we must not got a good case. I haven't read in the Bible about a bad case of the Holy Ghost yet. I hadn't read anywhere where there's a bad case of the Holy Ghost. It's not about the good or the bad case of the Holy Ghost. It's about, are you going to let that lead you when you walk out of here? Because you got the power still to grab that steering wheel and say, I'm going to direct my own life. How many people are attending church and they're still doing it by their own reasoning, by their own logic, by their own concepts of thinking, and they're not praying, and they're not pouring themselves out to God, and they're not dying out to God? I'm here to tell you today what Paul is talking about is a people who get full of the Spirit, and they live in the Spirit, and they walk in the Spirit, and they operate in the Spirit, whether it is in the middle of the week or on a weekend. They are Spirit-filled, overcoming children of God. This thing works. So Paul then, I'm still trying to get to my message, by the way. Paul then gives a short segment that absolutely nails the essentiality of this Spirit relationship. Romans 8, 15 through 17. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Did you hear that? It's not bondage. You feel like this group of people were bound this morning? Matter of fact, it's kind of people that come in and feel like they got 10,000 pounds on their arm, they can't raise their, all of a sudden find themselves wanting to kind of lift their hands up in the air. That's not bondage, that's liberty. That's liberty, that's freedom. Amen. We have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. This is not a fear-based thing, this is a faith-based thing. Amen. If you're here just simply because you're afraid to go to hell, you need to get a better relationship. For eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of the man the things that God has prepared for them that love him, not are afraid of him, but them that love him. This is a love relationship. This is a power relationship. Hey, you don't have to live in bondage. You don't have to live in addiction. You don't have to live in oppression. You don't have to live in any of that kind of stuff, because this gospel message works. We have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry. Now, I'm going to give you a quick Bible study that may leave you scratching your head. This is a short one. Whereby we cry, Abba, Father. That term is used three times in Scripture. Once by Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was praying, Abba, Father. Two times Paul makes reference to it in his epistles. Abba, Father. Both times that Paul makes reference to it, he says the same thing. And I'm going to read to you what he says after he said, Abba, Father. Why does he say, Abba, Father? What happens when we say, Abba, Father? The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit. Amen. That I disappeared. that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs and joint heirs with Christ Jesus, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. What was he saying? The term Abba is a Chaldee word that is never translated into the Greek and never translated into English. Guess what it means? It means Father. So he's really saying Father, Father, but he's not really saying Father, Father, because Abba is a term of endearment that only the closest of sons could use. You know how it is as a parent? You've got those things that your children call you. They don't call anybody else, and you can tell when one of your children calls your name because there's that connection with you, and Abba is that way. Father is a general term, but Abba is a specific term of a son of God. That's why Jesus could say it in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said, Abba, Father. It's like saying a special term of endearment. Hey, you are my Father, but more than just generalities. Now, when he says Abba in the Chaldee and he says Father in our case, the English, what he is saying is that my natural man, my natural self refers to him as Father, but the Holy Spirit in me that makes me a son of God calls him Abba. In other words, when I can say Abba, Father, it is an agreement between my human spirit and the Holy Spirit of God that is in me that I am a child of God. And that's why he said the Spirit beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. In other words, when he said this, we are not really bona fide children of God until my natural man can call him Father and that new birth in me can call him Abba. And when Abba, Father, is mentioned, that is the witness, Paul said, that I am a born-again child of God, and I can use a term of endearment reserved only for God's children. Amen. Why is this important? Because I'm talking to you about living a life in a higher dimension. I'm not talking about coming by and visiting the Holy Ghost once a week. I'm not talking about coming by here and feeling the Spirit on a Sunday morning worship service. I am talking about living in the Spirit. It all started in verse 1 when he said, there is therefore now no condemnation to them that walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. We're talking about walking in the Spirit. We're talking about living in the Spirit. We're talking about 24/7 walking and living in the Spirit of God. And that'll take you to a brand new dimension of living and a brand new life of victory and power. Amen. Paul spends some time then explaining how this groaning, and I could spend weeks on Romans 8. It is probably my favorite chapter in the Bible. Paul spends some time explaining how this groaning creation is eagerly waiting for the manifestations of the Son of God. It's like the earth has been for centuries waiting to hear the sounds of the sons of God on its surface. Amen. Because God said, you know, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, this not of yourself, not of works, lest any man should boast. And then he said, verse 10, for we are created in Christ Jesus unto good works, and paraphrasing, because he ordained from the beginning that he'd have a people who would walk in him, walk in the good works. And then in Acts 1, 8, Brother G-Day taught about it this morning. Ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses. And we use that word of power as dunamis in the Greek, which means miracle. And we think about parting the water to the Red Sea and raising the dead. But what he's talking about there is living an overcoming lifestyle where you're not bound by the sins of this world. And this world has been groaning for somebody to walk in righteousness. This world has been groaning for somebody to walk in holiness. This world has been groaning for somebody to say, you're not going to overcome me. You're not going to conquer me. This world has been groaning to hear the prayers of the sons of God. Going up to God. Amen. So we're fulfilling a desire. And then Paul addresses our future glory with God. And then he jumps back to the subject of our message. I finally got there. There is an amazing power in those who live according to the teachings of this chapter. And this power comes with the Holy Spirit working within those who walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh. I'm going to proclaim a few points from our original text this morning. First of all, as human beings, we do not always understand what we're praying against. Our understanding is limited, and you prayer warriors will quickly understand what I'm saying. You're praying sometimes, and you can't really identify what it is that you're praying because God understands these things, and we're just walking by faith. But what we come up against, to the Spirit-filled person, the Holy Ghost, the Bible said, will step in and pray through us. In other words, with groanings which cannot be uttered, or words that cannot be uttered. It's called praying in the Spirit, most often associated with praying in tongues. It takes a person to an absolutely other dimension in the Spirit. We simply become a conduit for God to pray through us, and this is a powerful experience. In other words, we run into something in prayer that we can't comprehend, but because we are full of the Spirit, the Holy Ghost starts praying through us. Isn't it amazing that God is praying His will into existence by praying through us, and the Holy Ghost makes intercession for us? And point number two, God knows the mind of the Spirit. So when the Spirit prays through us, God is praying His own will into existence in this world. Oh, I wish I could spend some time teaching you on prophetic prayer and the power of it. But if you need to understand, you can pray when you're full of the Spirit, and the Holy Ghost will step in, and you will step into a dimension of prayer that is powerful and overcoming. And God really steps in, and He said, listen, you don't understand, but the Holy Ghost begins to make intercession for you with groanings which cannot be uttered. Glory. And when a person gets to this place in the Spirit, he can claim the promise. Listen, we use this scripture as a standalone scripture. It's not a standalone scripture. Matter of fact, people use this scripture that don't have any right using it. For all things work together for good to them who are called according to His purpose. Amen. All things work together for good for them who are called according to His purpose. Amen. I'll go all the way back to that one and read it to you just in case I get it right. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. This is a powerful thing because when we allow the Spirit to pray through us, when we allow the Spirit to take us to a higher dimension of spiritual existence, then this promise comes into effect and everything works together for good. Everything, every ingredient comes together because we love Him and we are called according to His purpose. We are not just like the rest of the world. This last day week Christianity wants to say the only difference between Christians and people in the world is we're forgiven. There's a whole lot more difference than that. There is a power in the way we live. There's a power in the way we walk. There's a joy that we can have in our heart that the world didn't give it to me and the world can't take it away. There is a faith and a confidence that I will not be defeated and I will not be overcome because I've learned how to pray in the Spirit. And when I do, all things are going to work together for the good of them that love God and are called according to His purpose. Hallelujah. This promise does not work for the carnally minded. Sometimes I want to get up, but I'm not anybody's judge, but I still won't get up and do it. Don't steal my promise. People who live like the devil and then say he's gone to prepare a place for me. Well, he has. He's prepared two places. Amen. You can work on that one yourself. Well, God understands. He certainly does. It's you that don't. And I pray, God, to give us spiritual understanding and spirit. But this promise don't work for the carnally minded. You can't live like the devil, gratify your flesh, walk in the flesh, and walk in unrighteousness, and walk in here and say all things are going to work together for good to them that love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. Number one, if you love God, he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. So you're not keeping his commandments, so you don't love him. And that's what Jesus said. But if you love him, keep his commandments. I'm going to tell you what, nobody with an overcoming prayer life ever walked away from righteousness. Nobody with an overcoming prayer life ever walked away from holiness. Nobody with an overcoming prayer life ever walked away from the truth. You're not going to do it because there's going to be something burning on the inside of you that refuses to let go of the truth of God's word. Amen. So the first thing people do when they quit praying is they abandon truth to start a Facebook ministry. And it don't take anything for somebody who's got a prayer life to look at it and say that is a prayerless statement coming from a logical mind and they don't understand the word of God. And I'm not talking about bondage. I'm talking about liberty and freedom. This is how we were created to be. God created us to be overcomers. He created us to be more than conquerors. He created us to live victorious lives. He created us to be happy. Yeah, he created us to be happy. Then the bomb is dropped. If God is for us to the point that God himself will pray through us, then who can be against us? Now we take that scripture by itself. If God be for us, who can be against us? That scripture's not supposed to be by itself. That scripture's supposed to be in this train that I have, in this context that I've been preaching this morning. It only works if you understand that the Holy Ghost makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered, and God will pray through us until we have victory, and then all things work together for them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. And then I can say, if God is that much on my side that he will actually step in and pray through me, if God is that much on my side, if God is for me, then who in all creation could ever be against me? Some of you football fans, I'll try to use an illustration that touches your spiritual heart. A lot of NIL and transfers portals in college football have brought a parity, and teams that used to be unbeatable are all of a sudden beatable because there's a parity. But when you could get all the scholarships you wanted and stack your team and nobody could come and take them away from you and they couldn't leave and go to another school, then you could dominate. Getting close to home here, ain't I? Amen. But why am I saying this this morning? I'm not a football fan. I am just simply saying that when you have somebody on your side that is so good that it doesn't matter who's against them, bring them on. It don't matter. Bring the best one you can bring. It don't matter because the one on my side is the greatest that there is. And this is what Paul is saying. You can bring any principality or power. You can bring anything this world has to offer. I don't care what kind of team you put together against me because if God is for me, I won. If God is for me, the game's over. If God is for me, I'm going to come out on top. If God is for me, who shall be against me? Nobody. It don't matter who's against me. That's why we don't worry about the enemy. We worry about having God for us on our side. And when God is for us, it does not matter who's against us. Well, I could shake up the saints. Every time you preach about prophecy, it scares the saints to death and the sinners keep living the way they're living. What about the Antichrist? You believe we're going to be here with the Antichrist? Let me just tell you something. If the dude moves next door to me, that don't change the fact that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. So if my new neighbor walks up and says, I'm the Antichrist, I'm just going to say, hey, Bubba, you picked the wrong neighborhood. You picked the wrong subdivision this time, because I'm not afraid of you. God is not afraid of you. The church is not afraid of you. The church is an unstoppable force. Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So this becomes a place of safety, LaVonda. When I follow Romans chapter 8, I have suddenly arrived at a place of safety. And let me say something even more amazing than that. It is a place beyond deception. The Bible says in the last days, men will deceive and be deceived. And we are there. But when you get in this place, it don't matter. Let them say what they're going to say and do what they're going to do. I know the truth. Amen. I was in the city of Ames, Iowa, where my son-in-law and daughter now are pastoring. And I was there as a teenager, and I got to working on Iowa State University campus. And we ran across a young lady there who started the Unification Church, or the Mooney Movement there. She had 400 followers on Iowa State University campus. And she decided when she went home to South Dakota, Rapid City, South Dakota, for the summer, that she was going to convert Brother Jim Yowie, Pentecostal pastor. And somebody told him, said, don't mess with the Pentecostals. They think they know the truth. But Cindy did it anyway. And for 3 months in her summer, she would go to Pastor Yowie's office and try to convert him to the Unification Church and to Mooneyism. At the end of the service, or at the end of the summer, Pastor Yowie carried her back to the baptistry, baptized her in the name of Jesus Christ, and God filled her with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. There's something powerful. Yeah. You say, well, you're not supposed to think you've got the truth nowadays. It's not politically correct to think you're right. I don't think I'm right. I know I'm right. And if that bothers you, then get bothered. Hey, because a lot of people don't know. I know, because I know what the Bible said. I've spent my life reading that book. And what I'm preaching to you in this service this morning is absolutely biblical truth. And I'm not going to get up here and act like it's not, because I am 1,000% sure that I'm preaching to you the truth this morning. You say that's arrogant. No, that's bold. There's a difference. It's a place where we can't be defeated. Did you get what I just said? It is a place where we cannot be defeated. I'm talking about living in a higher dimension. Do you have scripture for that? Well, I'm so glad you asked. But I will say, it's not for the carnally minded. It's for those who choose to live what I'm preaching this morning. But just to show you that it's a place that you can't be defeated, let's wrap up this chapter in Acts chapter 8, verse 33. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or our nakedness, our peril, our sword, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I'm talking about living in a higher dimension, living in a higher dimension, living in a higher dimension. Let's stand together. Yes, it is possible to live in this state, Brother Cedric. It is possible, but only if the provisos of the entire chapter have been met. No outward force can separate me from God if I have this kind of prayer life and I walk in the Spirit. And Jesus himself said, no man can pluck them out of my hands. This is a higher dimension. This is a place for overcomers. This is a place for people who will not be intimidated by this world and end time spirits. Too many are just trying to avoid hell. But some of us want to walk in the Spirit. Some of us want to live above the groveling of this world. And there's only one way. Be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Be led by the Spirit of God. Have an overcoming prayer life and experience a higher dimension of living. This is not a promise to a few, but something that is available to every person on this earth. The Roman Catholic Church, somewhere in the mid 400 to 500, maybe 600 AD, introduce a doctrine called monasticism. And that doctrine was, since a lot of people were not living righteously, they decided that the righteous living was for an elite few. It was monastic. And everybody else is going to be all right, but that righteous few had to live righteously. We don't believe in monasticism. We believe the preacher lives righteously. We believe the members of the church live righteously. We believe the Bible's for everybody in the house. We believe the truth is for everybody in the house. We believe the power is for everybody in the house. I believe the power is for everybody in Gadsden, Alabama. I believe the power is for everybody under the sound of my voice and not under the sound of my voice. Hallelujah. But we need to obey and accept the provisos that God has given us. It all begins with being filled with the Holy Ghost. And guess what? That can happen right now. Why don't you cut sin's losses short? Don't go back out there for another round of it. Cut sin's losses short and say, God, this is the place where I draw the line in the sand. You have anointed me to be a being full of your Spirit and to have a testimony of an overcomer in this world, because our world has been groaning for people like me, for sons of God, to hear the voices of the sons of God going up in prayer, praying, will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Oh, there is so much faith right now in this house that if you will be bold enough to just step out and just come down here and say, God, this is the way I want to live. This is the way I want to live. Come on, somebody, be bold enough to do it. Be bold enough. Hey, listen. Living for God is for the bold. Living for God are those who want to cut their losses in this world and get out of it. Living for God are those who say, I want to enjoy the pleasures of God, not the pleasures of sin. Oh, hallelujah. There is a miracle power I feel in this service this morning right now. If you will just step out and take advantage of it, something is going to happen in your life that has never happened before. That's it. Breakthrough. Breakthrough. You ready to fight? Got anybody wants to fight? You want to fight? You feel called to fight? Come on. Come on. Come on.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded
by you. Yeah.
Like
come
I'm
on. There's some more of you need to break out of that shell. Get out of it. Come on.
It may look like
run for your life. Run for your life. Run for your life.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Is a choice. It's a choice you make. But if you will step into God's presence, you don't have to face addiction.